So the project here is part of a series of papers that I'm doing on climate change. And that's something I've been teaching as well. It's something I worry about. I assume most of you worry about it as well. Let me just sort of say what the general project is. And that is that, I teach in the School of Public Policy at University of Toronto as well as in the Department of Philosophy. And so I think about policy questions. And I'm very interested in the policy debates around climate change. So I've been very involved in Canada in the debate over appropriate policy responses, carbon taxation, and so forth. What you see in the policy debate is that there are a variety of really interesting normative questions that get raised in the policy debate. And there are a lot of really difficult problems that occur within that policy debate. So, I mean, so the question of like what kinds of instruments are appropriate for combating climate change, but also what should the appropriate balance be between mitigation and adaptation? Or how high, something simple like how high should carbon taxes be, right? Like what's an appropriate level? Most people don't think zero is the correct price for carbon, but most people don't think $500 per ton is the correct price for carbon. So what is the correct price for carbon? Turns out a number of very difficult normative questions get raised as soon as you start to pose these very practical policy questions. Then if you then turn to the normative literature, and in particular, if you turn to the literature produced by philosophers, and so you look at a textbook on environmental ethics, hoping to be able to address these normative questions by looking at the work that's been done by environmental ethicists and philosophers, I think most of you would have the same experience I had, which is that it's extremely disappointing. Because what you find in the textbooks and in the philosophical work is absolutely no value at addressing the normative questions that arise within the policy debate. So a lot of it is very interesting, but it just doesn't give you any traction on the policy questions. And that's too bad, because one of the things that philosophers have been doing has been essentially tacitly ceding the whole discussion to economists. Because economists are actually able to provide answers to those questions that politicians are coming and asking them, like how high should carbon taxes be? They have a framework. So, Theory of Justice was published in 1971 with the ambition of displacing utilitarianism from being the dominant public philosophy. And yet, if you look at debates over climate change, you see once again, like, what's the dominant philosophy that's being used to inform these debates? It's good old-fashioned utilitarianism as sort of mediated by economists. So it's extraordinary the extent to which philosophers have had no input whatsoever into the policy discussions, even in cases where politicians and, negotiators are explicitly saying, we could really use some help here from moral philosophers. And yet moral philosophers have not been able to engage in that policy discussion. So there are some reasons for that. It turns out there are a lot of reasons for that. One of it is that there's at least the policy debate is structured by at least four different assumptions or sort of, ways of thinking about the problem. All four of which are typically rejected by environmental ethicists. And so there's this huge chasm between the way that, when someone starts talking about the policy, people say, oh, stop right there, I disagree with that. Stop right there, I disagree with that. There's a whole bunch of like stop right there moments, right? So there's a huge distance between the policy debate simply because of this unwillingness to accept the way in which the problem is framed. So what I've done is a series of papers that try to suggest that there are ways that philosophers could accommodate themselves to the structure of the policy debate in such a way that they could make a more useful contribution to the sort of normative questions that arise within the policy debate. So this is just one of those papers, it has to do with growth, which is that if you look at the policy debate, if you look at the IPCC reports, all of it is premised on the assumption that there is going to be economic growth, right? So everyone is working with the growth model. And then the question of mitigation versus adaptation, et cetera, is all posed within the framework of a growth model, right? And that's, again, the IPCC consensus. That model and that sort of scenario, however, is widely rejected by, activists on the environmental front, by environmental ethicists, and also by philosophers. I think that's deeply problematic, so I'm going to say some things about why it is that the IPCC models all presuppose a growth framework. But also, once you start adopting a growth framework, you suddenly discover the weakness of our normative theories at addressing the basic problems of climate change. So utilitarians have a consistent position, which is that they care about economic growth and they care about climate change. But all the non-utilitarian positions have a problem in this department, because people often subscribe to the view, utilitarians like welfare maximizing, those kinds of views, right? But if you look at the dominant other sort of political philosophies, not talking about moral philosophies, but look at, say, liberal egalitarianism, all the stuff, all the views are kind of descendant of Rawls. They tend to get themselves into an embarrassment when it comes to addressing climate change, because they adhere to two propositions that are in tension with one another. So the first proposition is that they claim that climate change represents an injustice that we're perpetrating against future generations. So if we allow this to go unchecked, we're committing an injustice against, you know, people who will be living in the future. And therefore we owe some kind of mitigation effort to counteract this injustice. And then the second proposition that's in tension with it, though, is that they say, however, we do not owe them any of the fruits of economic growth. Like, we don't owe them a growing economy. And those two things are in tension. Why? Just because the benefits of growth are so large relative to the damages. The potential benefits of growth are so large relative to the anticipated damages of climate change. It's difficult to say, like why it is that we can't inflict this relatively small harm on them. But we're, like, it's totally fine just to, like, not, you know, we're in a position to make their economy 10 times larger, but we just have no obligation to do that whatsoever. So there's a tension that arises within non-utilitarian theories. So that's what I try to develop in the paper. The upshot of it is actually a point about, it's a kind of philosophical point more than a sort of environmental point, which is that we haven't thought seriously enough, non-utilitarians haven't thought seriously enough about these problems and what an adequate normative theory for addressing the problem of climate change would look like. So the first thing I just want to say just intuitively then about growth is that the in the case of climate change, we have a kind of reverse Malthusianism, right? So Malthus's pessimistic view about future scarcity was based upon this contrast between the tension between our capacity to reproduce and our capacity to increase the food supply. And Malthus's argument, you recall, was that reproduction kind of increases geometrically, that is, it's exponential, whereas our capacity to bring new agricultural land under cultivation and increase the food stock is something that increases kind of arithmetically. It's not literally arithmetic, but it's not exponential the way population can increase. And therefore, it's kind of structural that population is going to outstrip our capacity to produce food, right? So that was the basis of Malthus's pessimism. Now, with respect to climate change, however, there's a kind of reverse Malthusianism, which is that if you're looking at economic growth versus carbon abatement efforts, what you find is that economic growth has exactly that same exponential structure, namely that it expands very, very rapidly, whereas climate change is like more like an arithmetic function in terms of damage, simply because, I mean, as temperatures get very, very high, you start to get exponential damage functions, but that the run-up to that temperature increase is one which is relatively slow, so it kind of resembles Malthus's agricultural production. And so there is a view that says that you should put off doing anything significant with respect to climate change, simply because in the interim period while climate change is sort of slowly accelerating, you can get this massive sort of bang for the buck out of economic growth. So one of the reasons why these arguments are often difficult to assess by non-economists is just that growth is really, really unintuitive. So this sort of explosive character of economic growth is often not fully appreciated by philosophers. I sometimes give the example, like in 1997, it's in the paper, like in 1997, when China decided not to sign on to the Kyoto Accord, had a variety of reasons for doing that. But since that time, China's per capita GDP is four times larger than it was in 1997. Right? So their view was that they should be able to engage in unconstrained economic development and growth, and shouldn't be, in 1997, shouldn't be trying to undertake significant carbon abatement. Why? Because 20 years from now, they're going to be significantly richer. And as a result, they're going to be in a better position to engage in carbon abatement efforts. Now, 20 years ago, a lot of people looked at that and said, oh, you know, poo-poo-poo, right? But then, of course, history has shown that the economy of China has quadrupled in the last 20 years. And last year, China actually did reduce its carbon emissions. And so you can see that there's at least a case to be made for the claim that 1997 was in fact not the right time for China to be engaging in significant carbon abatement. And again, it all hinges upon the explosive character of economic growth because of its being exponential. Anyway, so I sometimes give this to my policy students where I say exponential functions are unintuitive, and therefore it's a real problem when it comes to thinking about growth. It's also a problem when it comes to the debate over the discount rate, which is kind of a niche argument about climate change. is exponential functions are unintuitive. So often the moral philosopher's approach of thinking about it intuitively leads one astray, simply because you're dealing with an unintuitive quantity. So here's an example. If you take $1,000 and you invest it at an interest rate of 5% for a period of 100 years, it generates, at the end of 100 years, a sum of $131,000. Now, suppose that instead of investing it at 5%, you were to invest it at 8%. And then the question is just guess how much it produces at the end of 100 years. Just like ballpark it, right? Come up with a number. And most people come up with a number which is much smaller than the actual number, right? Which is to show that a relatively slight difference in the interest rate generates a massive difference in the actual quantity of the investment at the end of 100 years. Again, just to sort of show that growth is unintuitive. And a lot of the policy decisions we're making make that kind of a difference to economic growth. That is, if you can increase growth by 2 or 3 percentage points, that's within the capacity of developing countries, right? So these are kind of, you know, like real world numbers, they're not made up. Yeah, so this shows actually why utilitarians think that growth is a really, really big deal, because if you're interested in maximizing welfare, and the tendency is to treat the welfare of future people as being roughly equivalent to the welfare of present people, then you actually, investment generates huge increases in human welfare, right? So utilitarianism actually encounters a version, an extreme version of the demandingness objection, which is that it actually, within a utilitarian framework, becomes unclear. Like, look at that, you know, you're eating that cookie. Like, you know, if you had not eaten that cookie and had invested it, the amount of wealth embodied in producing that cookie could have, you know, generated a whole meal for a starving family 100 years from now, right? Therefore, you shouldn't, now you're drinking wine, like it's out of control, like it's out of control, right? It becomes a real problem about why we should be able to meet any of our consumption needs, given that if we're deferring consumption and investing it instead, I mean, you know, instead of, you know, consuming $1,000 this month, you could set it aside and 131 people could have $1,000 100 years from now, right? So utilitarianism actually gets into an embarrassment, which is that future benefits so completely trump current consumption that it becomes very unclear why we're entitled to consume anything in our economy whatsoever. That's in fact the primary motivation for introducing a discount rate, which is that if you don't make future people count for less, then the mere fact that you can make investments in growth is exponential means that future people totally outweigh the interests of present people. Right? That's the motivation for discounting. All right, so forget about utilitarians. Now think of the kind of Rawlsian egalitarian view. It suffers exactly the opposite problem, and it's a huge embarrassment for the theory, which is that the Rawlsian view, I mean, so the utilitarian view puts way too much weight on the interests of people who aren't born yet. The Rawlsian view puts far too little weight upon the interests of people not yet born. In fact, a simple-minded application of Rawls's original position, in fact, puts zero weight on the interests of future generations. So, and Rawls kind of realized this already in the theory of justice, where, I mean, one way in which you could respond to future generations, you could say, well, just stick them in the original position, right? And imagine an original position, you don't know what generation you belong to, and then choose a policy behind a veil of ignorance, et cetera, et cetera. Now that generates the paradox of perpetual poverty, because Rawls's difference principle assigns lexical priority to the worst off individual, and given the possibility of productive investment, the worst off generation is us right now, right? Because any investment we make is gonna make people better off in the future. So it makes it impermissible to improve the human condition. Right, because any improvement in the human condition exacerbates inequality, because, oh, poor us, right? We're the worst off, right? And if a view that assigns lexical priority, therefore assigns zero weight to the interests of future generations. So that's obviously a crazy implication. So Rawls did a bunch of sort of hand-waving to avoid this problem. A lot of other Rawlsians have done hand-waving to avoid that problem. And so often what sort of people of an egalitarian, liberal egalitarian temperament arrive on is a kind of sufficientarian view, where they say that what's needed is a kind of equal opportunity across generations, not lexical priority. So you don't do the difference principle, but you have a kind of egalitarian principle. So there are lots of different formulations of it, but people just sort of say, so Brian Berry has a formulation which says that our obligations to future generations are to ensure that they have opportunities to lead good lives equal to our own. Right? So it's a kind of sufficientarian. We reach a plateau where you can say now people can achieve a good life, and then our goal is just to not worsen things in the future. Right? So I call that a steady state view, which says that once you reach a certain level of human development, then you can plateau it off. And then in the environmental literature, people are also familiar with it because of the Brundtland definition of sustainable development, which has something similar, right? So it's development that allows us to meet our needs without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs, right? That implies just to get a sufficiency plateau. We shouldn't be worsening their condition. And the basic problem with that view is that it's far too easy to satisfy. And so I give an example in the paper. If you were to, and the reason why it's too easy to satisfy, of a variety of reasons, but technological development is a major factor that makes it, it makes it so that we can actually engage in dramatically depletionary environmental policies and yet not be violating our obligations to future generations. So an example I give, just like picked almost at random, but in the last 50 years in the United States, multi-factor productivity in agriculture has increased by 250%. So multi-factor productivity is all the gains in productive capacity that are not caused by an increase of capital or labor. Right? So it essentially is a residuum designed to capture improvements in technique. Right, so multi-factor productivity has increased by 250%. So what that means is that 50 years ago, U.S. farmers could have started destroying agricultural land. And they could have destroyed 60% of the agricultural land in America without violating, for example, the Brundtland definition of sustainability or a sufficientarian view. Because we would still, like, you know, now be able to produce exactly as much as they were able to then, because while they destroyed 60% of the farmland, the remaining 40% is so much more productive that our capacity to produce agricultural goods is unaffected by their actions. Right, so that, I think, should strike most people as being wrong. That's far too easy to satisfy. So anyhow, the argument on climate change is basically that, is going to be the argument. So it's actually a really, really simple argument and a simple observation. But there are a lot of objections to the framing of the argument. And so what most of the paper does is deal with objections to the framing of the argument. So that's actually what I'm going to start by talking about. So number one objection to all this is that a lot of people, like, right away want to get off the train by saying, well, you're talking about growth as though this is something that could actually happen. And as everyone knows, there's, like, strong hostility to growth. Naomi Klein is into degrowth. You know, there are lots of people who think that there's various formulations of the thesis. One is that growth, continuing economic growth, is impossible, and therefore at some point it's going to screech to a halt. So that's a view that was popularized by the Club of Rome and Limits to Growth, and it's been kind of around ever since. Another view is that growth is normatively undesirable, and that what we would be able to produce is actually just sort of an illusion of growth. Because growth, as we know, I mean, GDP is a kind of crazy statistic in terms of what it measures and what it doesn't measure. And so if you're generating massive environmental externalities, even if you're generating GDP growth, as the environmental externalities become more significant, they may be undermining it. And so in terms of overall welfare impact, you may not be actually growing at all. All these are variants of the same thing, which is to say that the environmental situation is one which is going to put a hard cap or a constraint on our capacity to actually increase welfare through growth. Now, so I think this view is mistaken, and so I want to forestall it, but, you know, before getting into my specific argument about climate change. Why? Because if this view were correct, then obviously there's nothing to talk about, right? So there's two things that need to be said about it. I think the most important thing is that the limits to growth thesis is often articulated in a way that sounds as though it's very, very wise, but in fact is actually confused. And so I picked two examples of it that have been very influential in the last decade. So one by Tim Jackson, this book, Prosperity Without Growth, and then one by, my colleague at York, Peter Victor, Managing Without Growth. And they both, you'll notice, articulated exactly the same way. And it's the way they pick up, it's a long-standing way of talking about it. And Herman Daly's Steady State Economics is probably the text of this stuff, right? And they articulate it using a kind of systems-y language. So they say that the way an economist thinks about the world is the wrong way of thinking about the world. If instead one adopts an ecologist's perspective and thinks about it in system language, then you realize that limitless growth is impossible. So here's how Tim Jackson says it. He says, the idea of a non-growing economy may be anathema to an economist, but the idea of a continually growing economy is an anathema to an ecologist. No subsystem of a finite system, right, so there's the systems language, can grow indefinitely in physical terms. Economists have been able to answer the question of how a continually growing economic system can fit within a economists have to be able to answer the question of how a continually growing economic system can fit within a finite ecological system. And there is actually a super easy answer to that, is that when economists talk about growth, they're not talking about physical growth. All right, so you saw how like there's like a clear like non sequitur in the last and the penultimate sentence, right? So the penultimate sentence says that no subsystem of climate system can grow in physical terms, and then suddenly that puts the onus on the economist to explain how growth is possible, right? But as everyone should know, GDP does not measure growth in physical terms. Right? So Soviet five-year plans used to measure the size of the economy in physical terms. That is, they used to literally say, we want this million tons of steel, we want so many pigs, we want so many pounds of bacon, et cetera, right? We want this many shoes. It was a measure of physical output. Whereas GDP does not measure physical output. GDP, I mean, it's a fiddly thing, but it measures the value of transactions that occur within society, including taxation and public goods provision. And as a result, GDP is a bit noisier than a measure of physical output. And again, I don't quite understand, what Jackson does, he acknowledges this at various points, but he constantly slips back into a mode of talking about growth as involving material flows and of material production. But GDP does not measure material production. It measures that as a subset of a wide range of other things, many of which are immaterial. Now, surprisingly, the vocabulary for drawing this distinction is right there in Herman Daly in Steady State Economics, where he draws a distinction between quantitative and qualitative growth. One way in which you can improve qualitative growth is you can simply improve the allocation of resources and of consumption goods. And so you could have an unchanged quantity of goods being produced. And yet, if you're able to generate a superior allocation of those goods, this is what Daly calls qualitative growth, that's going to register as economic growth because the goods have more value to the individuals now who are being allocated those goods. And as a result, their willingness to pay for them is higher. So you can have qualitative growth, you can have quantitative growth. Now, it typically is the case that the two are hooked together. Namely, that if you improve the economy qualitatively, that frees up resources to increase quantitative growth as well. But in principle, the two of them are distinct. What Jackson himself recognizes is there wouldn't be a limit to growth if it were possible to engage in so-called dematerialization or decoupling. In other words, if it were possible to have qualitative growth without quantitative growth, then the thesis would be null. And I don't know how many people, if anyone's read Jackson's book, but there's a lot of fishy stuff in there, because his book is called Prosperity Without Growth, right? So he doesn't want to take away everything. He wants there to be prosperity. He just doesn't want there to be growth. And he gets himself into huge trouble because he's very negative about decoupling. But then what is prosperity? Well, it turns out that prosperity is just decoupled growth, right? So the whole book is a kind of reductio of its own central thesis. Victor I'll take questions afterwards. Victor is more careful about these things, and so doesn't make that particular mistake. But at the same time, he has a similar sort of systems level, like systems language formulation, that I think is misleading. So here's what Victor says. He says, a different conception of economy that provides a better starting point for a book on growth is as an open system with biophysical dimensions. An open system is any complex arrangement that maintains itself through an inflow and outflow of energy and material from and to its environment. So again, his view is that, he articulates it this way, you have the economy, which economists think of as kind of the totality of social transactions, but he says instead should be put within a broader ecological framework and thought of as being a system that draws in resources and then produces waste. And then it says that if the resources are finite or the absorptive capacity of the system to absorb waste is finite, then eventually the system is not going to be able to either draw in or output and therefore is going to be constrained. And that basic picture is what gives him the limits to growth thesis. But that picture is also extremely misleading, if not false. And it's fundamentally, it's the same picture that informed the Club of Rome's model, what William Nordhaus calls lethal models, which is that if you have, if you ever assume a model with finite resources, then naturally, that to the extent that it draws resources, it's going to have a limit to growth. Simply because if you have finite resources, eventually they run out,
right?
And to the extent that growth involves consumption of those resources, that's it for your growth. What it doesn't countenance is the possibility of, I mean, in the case of the Club of Rome stuff, technological development. But also the fact that the wastes are not necessarily wastes. That is, that there's a kind of unhelpful hypostatization of this idea of resources and waste. So if you look, for example, like fossil fuel is typically presented as a resource. And so we draw upon fossil fuel and then we produce waste, carbon dioxide and so on and so forth. But what exactly has happened when we burn fossil fuel, right? The components of the fossil fuel have not disappeared, right? They're still out there. The same way like when we consume iron or any of these finite resources, it's still out there, right? Like your car rusts and it gets dispersed in the form of rust, right? Or, you know, fossil fuel is burned and it takes the form of carbon dioxide and water and a variety of other pollutants. But, you know, we're perfectly capable of reversing that reaction, right? There's a company in Alberta which is able to produce diesel fuel through a combination of water and atmospheric carbon dioxide, right? So it draws carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, combines it with water, and produces diesel fuel. Now, what's the trick, right? Well, the trick is that that requires a massive amount of energy. And their process is solar powered, and so it's using the right kind of energy to do it, right? And the technology is not there to do it on an industrial scale, but what it proves in principle is that it's wrong to characterize diesel as a resource and then carbon dioxide as a waste. It's all that we've done is we've taken something that's in a high energy state and we've reduced it to a low energy state. Namely that hydrocarbons have a high level of energy in the chemical bond, which by burning we rupture and we produce things in a low energy state. But with sufficient energy, we can reverse that process. Now, this is something, again, which is broadly recognized in the limits to growth thesis and in the literature. But Daly as well covers all of this stuff back in the 70s. And he says, yeah, therefore the limits to growth take the form of the solar energy budget. It's the fact that ultimately all the energy comes from the sun. It's not, there's a little bit of geological energy, but it's trivial, right? Therefore it's the sun that puts the hard cap on growth. And that's kind of true, but not really important. Because if you look at human energy consumption right now, human energy consumption amounts to approximately 17 terawatts. And that's expected to rise to about 43 terawatts by the end of this century. The solar energy budget is over 89,000 terawatts. And that's after albedo. That's what strikes the planet's surface at any particular point in time. Right? So human consumption of energy, I mean, the planet is literally awash with energy. The problem is that we have a pathetic inability to actually transform that energy into usable form. Right? So there is, in fact, some truth to a limits to growth thesis, but you know, it's kind of academic in the pejorative sense of the term, right? It's not a significant constraint. So you know, all of it depends upon energy technology and the capacity to, you know, to usefully harness solar energy. So I actually think that the intellectually coherent version of the limits to growth thesis is something like the thesis put forward by Thomas Homer Dixon in The Ingenuity Gap, where he just comes out and says, I'm just betting against technological progress. Right? So in The Ingenuity Gap, he says basically, humans are running out of ingenuity. So we invented all this nifty stuff, but we're not going to be able to in the future. And often the limits to growth thesis depends upon that. Right? If you think that human ingenuity is going to run out, then there is a sense in which growth could stop. But if human ingenuity continues, in particular our capacity to transform energy and to improve energy technology, then there's no basis for the thesis whatsoever. So it really should be presented as a bet against technological development, not as a kind of systems theoretic, like scientific, you know, thing that economists don't understand. All right. So once that's out of the way, then the climate change stuff is easy. So economic growth is going to continue. Climate change is going to be enormously disruptive and costly, but it is not going to depress the rate of growth below zero. That is, we're not looking at climate change creating a degrowth scenario. However, there are a lot of philosophers who write on the topic who seem to have this impression that climate change is going to be part of a legacy that involves a net harm to future generations. And that is not the assumption that informs the policy debate. Right, so the policy debate is predicated on the assumption that future generations are going to be better off than we are, but they're not going to be as well off as they might have been absent climate change. The philosophical discussion is structured by this idea that we're going to harm future generations. And then, of course, the normative question is easy, right? You know, should I punch you in the face? No, I shouldn't, right? Why? Because it's not nice to harm people, right? Should we harm future generations, right, by making the Earth uninhabitable? No, of course not. Why? Because we shouldn't harm people, right? So that simplifies the normative question. But unfortunately, it's based upon, a factual assumption which is not shared in the policy debates. So you get articulations like the following. So Tim Mulgan says, in Ethics for a Broken World, he imagines a scenario. The broken world is a place where resources are insufficient to meet everyone's basic needs, where a chaotic climate makes life precarious, and where each generation is worse off than the last. Right? And that's just the introduction. Then off he goes discussing the normative questions that are raised by this. McKinnon says something a little wild. I mean, actually, the book is very sensible, but she says something kind of wild at the beginning. She says, in worst-case scenarios of runaway climate change, Homo sapiens could go extinct, right? So again, that dramatically simplifies the normative question, right? Should we make the Earth uninhabitable for humans? No, we shouldn't, right? That's fairly straightforward. But this appears to be based upon like a misreading of what the state of the debate is about climate change. So how do people get this idea that where there's going to be an absolute worsening of people's condition in the future? Part of it comes from the fact that many documents that discuss the costs of climate change present the information in a highly misleading fashion. So I spend most of the time talking about the Stern Review on the Economics of Climate Change, which is just useful because it's very comprehensive and publicly available. But I came across this other example I'm going to give you. So this was a paper that was published in Nature. It was like a really big deal, a really interesting methodological paper estimating the cost of climate change by looking in variants of GDP historically based on temperature variation in countries. But there was this is the headline that was generated. So the abstract said the following. Unmitigated climate change is expected to reshape the global economy by reducing average global incomes by roughly 23% by 2010. And that was from the abstract was what got picked up, and these are Berkeley professors, became headlines in newspapers across the nation, et cetera, et cetera. So then you look in the actual paper, and this is what the paper says. after like all this methodology, all these calculations, climate change reduces projected global output by 23% by the end of the century relative to a world without climate change, right? So that last clause is a very important qualification. Right, because the abstract makes it sound, and I read it to like a bunch of people to test this out, right? Like you read the abstract sentence, that makes it sound like people are gonna be 23% worse off than we are right now. But that's actually not what the paper says. What it says is that people are gonna be 23% worse off than they might have been had we done something about climate change, right? And that's not an absolute worsening of condition, that's a relative worsening compared to what we might, it's a failure to maximize their welfare. And the Stern Review does essentially the same thing. So here's how Stern, as I'm sure everyone in this room knows, I mean, Stern called for fairly dramatic action in the short term to engaging in climate change mitigation. And this is a kind of typical way in which he presents his results. So this is just grabbed directly from the Stern Review. So what he does is he graphs out, and what the graph is showing is the percentage loss in GDP per capita from climate change based on temperature change under different sort of calculations that he's run, different scenarios. Again, this makes it look as though what he's projecting is an absolute decline in living standards. And in some of his formulations, he says, he has the same unqualified formulation, where he'll say that, for example, like the Indian subcontinent is expected to suffer a loss of GDP by the end of the century of between 6% and 9%, right? So he'll formulate it just like that, period, right? But at other times, he formulates it with a qualification, where he'll say, no, India's expected to lose X amount of percentage of GDP, quote, compared to what could have been achieved in 2010 or in 2200 or whatever, right? In other words, it's loss of GDP compared to potential. It's potential GDP that's being lost, not actual GDP off the present. Stern's worst case scenario for India is that you get a 13% of loss of GDP compared to what it might have been by 2100. So what I just do in a couple figures in the paper is I show an alternative way of presenting that information. Taking Stern's worst case scenario, which is the 13% by the end of century. So here's one way in which you could look at India's growth trajectory. So India is projected to, the economy of India is projected to increase by 40 times from the year 2000 to the year 2100. It's already easily on track to beat that. So this is like at an average growth rate of 3.8% per year. India's been growing at a rate closer to 6% in real terms. And so these are not like science fiction numbers or whatever, right? This is the concept, sort of like, it's actually compiled from about 40 different studies projecting India's GDP growth in the next, over the course of this century. So India is projected to get significantly wealthier. So what I've done here is I've just showed Stern's calculation of the impact of climate change on the growth of GDP in India. So what the red line shows is the projected growth of India with that 13% loss from climate change. So that's what's called the business as usual scenario, where we just do nothing about climate change. And that's what India's economy looks like. Whereas if we engage in an efficient level of carbon abatement, the blue line shows what the optimal growth trajectory for India looks like. And as you can see, this is like one of these kind of how to lie with statistics things, right? This makes it look trivial. It's actually not trivial. Like, the gap between the blue line and the red line in 2010 is massive, right? In fact, it's 5 times larger than the average per capita GDP at the beginning of the century. So you're talking about sacrificing a huge amount of potential GDP. So no one's trivializing the damages from climate change. But it's important to recognize that people in the future are also going to be dramatically better off than we are now. And so the survey view kind of polarized debates amongst experts, that is economists who are reading it. The thing that they found controversial about Stern's recommendations, and in particular the low discount rate and the really aggressive carbon abatement that he wanted to undertake, one of the major points of objection to it was that the major benefits of that intervention were going to be experienced by people who were going to be vastly better off than we are now. And so a lot of people found it counterintuitive, because by Stern's own assumption, right, the benefits of his carbon abatement policies were going to peak at a time when average global GDP was going to be $135,000 US per capita, which is 13.5 times larger than it is now. Right, so people were kind of like, well, why should we be right now making these real sacrifices in present living standards to help these people who are going to be so much better off than us? So that was the economy. I mean, that was the debate that erupted amongst economists and policy experts in the wake of the Stern report. The public reception, I think, kind of just missed that. Why? Because of the way that Stern formulated it, which was really, really misleading. It made it seem as though there was going to be an absolute decline in living standards. So, all right. So here's the payoff for like the sufficientarian normative theory, which is that, again, it's just a variation on the fact that it's too easy to satisfy a sufficientarian view. So Katrina McKinnon has a Rawlsian sufficientarian view. So what she says is that we're not a, like, okay, go back a bit. You can see why the utilitarian is concerned. Because the utilitarian says, oh, look, you know, the blue line is the one we should be on. If we're on the red line, that's a severe dereliction of moral duty, right? Like, you know, we need to be making these people 20 times better off. Merely making them 19 times better off is totally unacceptable, right, to the utilitarian. So you can see why it's an issue for a utilitarian. But then when you look at it, you can start to see, well, but if you don't care about growth, well, then why do you care about the difference between the red line and the blue line? So imagine then, so what McKinnon says is, look, climate change is already happening, so there's no question that we're going to have to engage in compensation for people in the future. Namely, that we're going to have set-asides for adaptation and so forth, right? That, you know, 20 years ago, we might have been able to handle the whole problem with mitigation. Now it's simply no longer, the die is cast. It's no longer possible to handle it entirely through mitigation. So we're going to have set-asides for adaptation and compensation of people in the future. So she says what we need is a climate change compensation fund, where we have to make resources available to people. So sea level rise is going to harm people, so we have to be able to make investments building dikes and turning everything into Holland and so forth, right? In order so that people will not feel the impacts as severely of climate change. So we have to provide resources to people in the future to compensate them for the damage that we're currently doing with unchecked climate change. So she wants a climate change compensation fund. At the same time, she's sufficientarian. So she says we don't owe them growth. You know, once we hit an unspecified threshold, and she just takes Rawls as one of, like, ability to maintain just institutions. Once we hit that threshold, then everything beyond that is discretionary. So she doesn't say what the threshold is, so I just kind of picked one. And so I said, well, let's say, you know, 5,000 US GDP per capita, which is, like, really generous. It's certainly a lot more than what Rawls thought. The recent Club of Rome update called Beyond the Limits suggests that a sufficient level would be 350 US GDP per capita. Right? So there are lots of there's a lot of really, really undemanding sufficientarian views out there, okay? So 5,000 GDP per capita is pretty generous, and there's some empirical stuff to suggest that beyond that, you don't get a lot of bang for the buck in terms of health, life expectancy, infant mortality, et cetera, et cetera. Right? So the yellow line shows you what a sufficientarian view looks like for India, with 5,000 GDP per capita being the floor, which is that you grow. Once you hit 5,000, then you can level out, okay? Now, suppose that you do nothing about climate change. You're then also going to owe compensation to people, future Indians. So it's not going to be adequate to give them an economy capable of generating 5,000 US per capita. You're going to have to give them some more in order to defray the damages caused by climate change. And those are going to be just exactly as Stern projected, right? They're going to be the difference between the red and the blue line. So what I drew was what McKinnon's theory of justice implies that we owe to people in India. And that the green line there is basically the steady state, that is the sufficientarian floor, plus compensation for climate change. And what you can see is that the green line is, I changed the colors, that's not so helpful on the red line. The green line is far, far below the business as usual scenario in which we simply do absolutely nothing about climate change. Right? So she develops this whole book arguing that, like, there's a kind of theory of justice that says we owe them compensation. But the actual implication of her argument is that we can just do nothing. That if we just let the economy grow, then, and people say, oh my God, you wrecked the climate. And we're like, you know, don't worry about it. We grew your economy. And we didn't have to do that, right? If you don't have to give people a growing economy, then they can't really complain about climate change because on this view, you've adequately compensated them for those damages. Now, I find that to be a highly counterintuitive result. And one that shows a very significant weakness in the sufficientarian theory. Right? That is, if you don't owe them growth, suddenly all those benefits of growth become available for compensation. So I take that to be a kind of adequate response to McKinnon's view, which is kind of, I think, the clearest attempt to work out a Rawlsian approach to the problem. There's a bunch of other things that can be said about it, and so the remainder of the paper involves dealing with objections. The first objection I deal with is that, one obvious way to block this whole thing is to deny that there could be compensation. And so if you don't allow substitutability, if you take a strong sustainability instead of a weak sustainability framework, and you say that we owe them a climate of a certain, you know, with a certain average temperature, and you can't make up for it by giving them, you know, dams and stuff like that. So if you deny substitutability from artifactual to natural categories, then you can block this argument. And I have some sympathy for those arguments in certain areas of environmental policy, but in climate change I find it unpersuasive. Because I find that the major damages to climate change are human damage, the major damages that we worry about, that motivate the kind of dramatic policy action we're talking about, are damages to human beings, right? So the fact that, for example, like 10% of the current human population lives, you know, no more than 10 meters above sea level, right, and therefore is going to be displaced by sea level rise. That's a big, big problem for human beings. But it's not clear that environmentally it's that big a deal. You know, the sea has gone up and down, et cetera, et cetera. All right? And so there are some areas where we do things that are highly unnatural, where you really, it's an affront to nature. Whereas I find climate change to be like a huge problem. It's a fouling of our own nest, right? It's a huge problem for people, but not so obviously a huge problem for nature. And therefore, there's the argument against compensation I find less compelling in the climate change case. And then the other last argument, just wrapping up. The last thing is that there's also a framework that tries to opt out of this entire way of thinking about it by saying that it's actually not the business as usual damage that we're concerned about with climate change. It's not what happens in the most likely scenarios that's the issue. The issue is what happens under the low probability catastrophic scenarios. And therefore, what we should have is, instead of this kind of essentially cost-benefit framework for thinking about it, we should have a risk management framework for thinking about it. And we should, our climate change policy should be driven not by a concern over future welfare, but rather by a desire to take certain kinds of catastrophic scenarios off the table. So I just have a little thought experiment arguing that if that were the issue, there's a lot of ways you could address it that wouldn't involve engaging in any carbon abatement. So I find that really counterintuitive. So I don't think the catastrophe thing, although it's you know, nobody has the answer on this stuff in terms of how to manage catastrophes. It does represent a kind of alternative to this way of thinking about things. But I don't think it addresses the central policy issue that we're worried about, right? Which is that we're causing massive damages in the future to ordinary economic activities, right? And forcing migration of populations, reducing agricultural yields, et cetera, et cetera. That's a problem, independently of what happens in the catastrophe category. So there's a big long argument about how you deal with the catastrophe stuff, and which is, again, an attempt to kind of set it aside and say, it doesn't speak to the issue here that we need to address. So anyhow, the long and the short of it is that we need a better normative theory for how to think about future generations. Utilitarianism is able to register the concern about climate change, but it does so at the expense of having this extremely implausible view that we have this kind of hypertrophied concern about even small decreases in welfare in the distant future. I find that really implausible. The other normative theories on offer, I think, just don't register the concern. They don't explain why you can't just compensate away the problem. Right. So I have a kind of complicated view that tries to, you know, explain why we should care about it. But it's far too complicated to explain. So that'll be another paper some other day. Thank you.
Thank you.